Well, good afternoon. I would like to welcome you all to this presentation. My name is Kostas Panos. I'm a professor of EECS and director of CITRIS and the Barnato Institute. I would like to also welcome the people who are watching this online, including those on the other CITRIS campuses at UC Davis, UC Merced, and UC Santa Cruz. I also today would like, I'm very pleased to welcome one of our CITRIS partners, Technological de Monterrey, who is visiting together with a large delegation in order to promote the work that we're doing together. So logistically, everything with the lunch here is compostable except for the foil. So please use the green and black bins at the back. We have a couple of upcoming events that I would like to bring to your attention. The 2017 CITRIS at Tech de Monterrey seed funding opportunity is happening now. This is the reason our friends from Tech de Monterrey are here. The idea is that investigators from Tech de Monterrey, which happens to be the biggest private university of Mexico with about 90,000 students, quite significant, and of course investigators from the four CITRIS campuses are welcome to join together and apply for projects. The application deadline is due April 14 at 5 p.m. And we have all this information online for more details. Today, we have a CITRIS Foundry event. Foundry, of course, is our incubator. We are hosting a demo day at 6 p.m. here in the Barnato's auditorium to celebrate the graduation of the spring 2016 cohort. The demo day will serve as an opportunity for all the teams to share short presentations about their companies and showcase their accomplishments. And again, for more information and to register, you can go to the Foundry Spring 2017 at Eventbrite. Foundry Spring 2017. I think you can find a link on our website as well. Also speaking about the Foundry, well, with one cohort that is about to graduate, we're about to collect applications for the Spring 2017 cohort. The applications are due next week on the 26th of March at 11:59 p.m. And I have to tell you, last time we had a 10% selection rate. The Foundry is becoming quite desirable and very selective. So if you want to participate, please talk to us. CITRISFoundry.org has more information. And next week, because of the spring break, we'll not be holding a research exchange lecture. It is now my pleasure to present today's speaker. My colleague, Professor Michelle Marharbis from the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Sciences at UC Berkeley. Michelle's work focuses on the extreme miniaturization of technology focused on building synthetic interfaces to cells and organisms. He's known as one of the co-inventors of neural dust, an ultrasonic interface for vanishingly small implants in the body. His group is also known for developing the world's first remotely radio-controlled cyber beetle. You should have seen that. I mean, it's still on YouTube. It's quite amazing. This was named as one of the top 10 emerging technologies of 2009 by MIT's Technology Review, TR10, and was in Time Magazine's top 50 inventions for 2009. Michelle received his BS from Cornell, his PhD from Berkeley, under Professors Roger Howe and Professor Jay Kisley. His thesis work led to the foundation of Microreactor Technology Inc., which acquired in 2009 by PAL Corporation. Michelle is a senior member of the IEEE, a member of the Society of Neuroscience. He's also a Chan Zuckerberg Biohub investigator that was announced in 2017, a Baker Fellow in 2014, recipient of the National Science Foundation Career Award in 2009, a G Scholar, and Intel IMAP Fellow. Michelle's long-term goal is understanding developmental mechanisms as a way to engineer and fabricate machines. So please welcome Professor Marharbis.
All right, thanks. So, hopefully that's the right volume. They'll tell me otherwise inside. Okay, so we have, I figure, about 45 minutes, and I thought I'd give you an overview of what motivated the neural dust technology platform and some of the thinking behind it, where it is today and where it's going tomorrow. If those of you that saw the Bears talk, this is essentially the Bears talk, except I changed bears to citrus about 30 seconds ago, so about 5 minutes ago. So if you get up and leave, I won't feel bad if you want to watch it again. Okay. This has been an extremely fun ride for about 3 years. It's very interdisciplinary. I want to point out Jose Carmena, Elad Alon, and Jan Rabai, who are the other principal investigators, all colleagues here at Berkeley. Jose is a world-famous leader in brain-machine interfaces. Elad and Jan are world-known for their circuits and other technology developments, and Jan has been a pioneer in that area for many years. DJ and Ryan really are the two principal drivers as the grad students that did all the work. So I'm pretty proud of this. If you find yourself very interested in all of this, there's no way in a talk like this, nor would I want to dive into all of the math. There's quite a bit of math behind a lot of the slides I'm going to show you in 20,000 foot level. I would point you to three papers. There's an archive preprint that you can obviously access for free at any time. And let me back up. All three of these papers have DJ Se, S-E-O, as the first author, and you can find my last name in it somewhere, so if you Google those two names. But there's an archive paper that goes through the math that we released to everyone, kind of pointing out that we thought the idea would work. There's a Journal of Neuroscience Methods paper that then goes through the in vitro demonstration that we were right about the physics, and I'll make a joke about that later. And then there's the neuron paper that has the first demonstration of it in an animal model, which has really been the place where all of this exploded, which I'm going to show you in some detail in a little bit. Okay, so, you know, what motivated this? And there are two big motivations, and I would say they're pretty distinct. Others would argue otherwise, but I think it's good to keep them separate. And both of them really go back to Jose Carmena's work and his field in brain-machine interfaces, and Jose's been talking about this for a long time. So if you look at how we interact with our technology, right, you have a very sophisticated system up here, and you have very sophisticated systems here, and the way we communicate with them in both directions is extremely low bandwidth. And so the most blue sky reason for doing this, and I will admit it is blue sky, I don't want to give anybody any solar false hope, is that we could build direct connections to our technological gadgetry through brain-machine interfaces. Okay, so that's an overriding desire, I think, of more on the science fiction side. On a more realistic level that grounds us in problems that exist today that are readily addressable by this technology and will be, you will see over the next, certainly the next 6 months to a year, there's going to be some very interesting announcements, and then over the next decade you're going to see quite a lot of work, is the sense that this could help a lot of people with certain motor and other disabilities. And so let me talk a little bit about the two areas where that, the two subfields that have emerged in this area. The first, which is I think nicely encapsulated by this figure from Miguel Nicolás' paper from a few years ago now, is really the encapsulated by the term brain-machine interface. And it's based on quite a big literature now that has shown that if you can take recordings from the cortex, whether you're looking at spikes or other variants of that, and you are taking those, running them through some filter, some algorithm, increasingly, of course, this is all machine learning-based kind of stuff, and using that, decoding that, using that to drive some prosthetic, here shown as an arm, but it need not be an arm, it could be an exoskeleton, it can in fact be a speech prosthetic, it could be quite a number of things that essentially perform some function, which the user is aware of how well that function is working. What a whole field has emerged around the idea that you can then train on this loop. So if I'm trying to use a robot arm, over weeks of training, my neural net will adjust itself to do this better. And of course, in modern brain-machine interfaces, the system itself is also adjusting. It's a two-learner system. So the desire to do this is a big motivator for technologies today. Because in the end, the next thing I'm going to show you is there's a big problem technologically in doing this at the interface between the brain and the hardware. And that's what neural dust is all about, is starting to think about that problem. The other area that is hopping right now, it's an area with a lot of market interest, is sometimes called electroceuticals. This is a term that, to my knowledge, was coined by GlaxoSmithKline a few years ago, but I could be wrong. And that's the idea that in sort of duality with the central nervous system thing on the left, here, you could intervene in the peripheral nervous system, which is usually, I think you can all agree, easier to get to than drilling a hole in your head. And doing that, you might be able to address many, many disorders and conditions, because down at the bottom, it's nerves that are doing a lot of regulation. And so you can imagine there's a lot of interest right now in inflammation because of some pioneering work by Kevin Tracy and the Feinstein Institute over on the East Coast that showed that inflammatory responses and your peripheral nervous system are actually all interlinked, and they're all talking to each other, and your brain's taking data and putting sort of putting stuff back in. And so, for example, it turns out that if you can modulate certain activity in the vagus nerve, which is a very large nerve that innervates almost all of our torsal organs, you can modulate inflammation. You can imagine how powerful that is, and so on. There's just this idea that you could get at the nerves. But again, there's a technological problem in doing that. And one, in fact, that was recognized by GSK, among other people, and launched a whole series of funding initiatives to try to figure out what kind of technology you could use to this. So hopefully that makes sense, the fact that these are, you know, sort of, I gave you the science fiction view and then some more realistic near-term issues that I think you will absolutely see addressed over the next decade. And I'm happy to take some questions near the end if people are curious how. But now let me show you, let's start with brain-machine interfaces. Let me show you what it does look like when applied to human patients. The marquee clinical trial in this area is called the BrainGate trial, or set of trials. And what they did was applied this sort of cartoon I showed you in the previous slide on the left to patients that were either locked in or quadriplegic. And what was done was an array, which I'll show you in the next slide, was introduced into the cortex that could record. It's introduced into the actual tissue of the cortex and can record signals from it. It has many, many different electrodes. The next slide will make some people squeamish, so finish your food quickly. You have 45 seconds to finish your shawarma. And then this was closed appropriately, and then you have these boxes on top, which consist largely of amplifiers and front-end conditioning circuitry to take those signals and then run them out. Now, what was demonstrated with this was remarkable, and one of the things I think at a human level, when you see, this is all on YouTube, you can look for these, when you see the quite understandable but very powerful emotional reaction of these patients as they can see that they've acquired some new sort of control of the environment using this is pretty, it would affect you, I think. But that's what it looks like in, this is the state of the art today in actual demonstrated in humans. Academically and in companies, it's quite a bit ahead, and I'll show you that in the next few slides, but this is the grounding of reality today. Now, there are a lot of ways of taking data out of the brain, and I can't talk about all of them. I actually have a tutorial I give sometimes, and it's like hours long. I have to go into a lot of details. But suffice it to say that somewhere between EEG, which we all know sits outside the head and doesn't usually require any intervention clinically, but is very low resolution and really not very good for very serious clinical stuff, with some exceptions, but generally it's a very crass thing, down to what I described, which is getting right into the cortex next to a neuron and recording that, is a wide spectrum of interventions which my group is involved in, and we don't quite have enough time to talk about it, but I'm happy to discuss. Just be aware that there are a lot of ways that people are attempting to take data out of the brain and put it back in. But the one I just showed you, the arrays look like this. This is it should have a citation, I apologize. This is from a 2010 review paper in Frontiers of Neuroscience, which is very nice. And it shows you all the different types of shanks that different groups have made. And these things, which are on order of a millimeter long and tens of microns wide usually, get pushed in, as you're about to see here. This is an image of these arrays about to be pushed into the cortex. And you can see all the vasculature under there. That'll matter in a minute. But they all have different, you know, ways of doing this, but you can kind of get a sense of what they all look like. Okay? So let me skip this slide. So what do you want when you build one of these things? right? If you're building either the thing I just showed or very similar technologies for peripheral nerves, or you're trying to wrap around a nerve or go into a nerve, well, whatever you're building better be able to detect the signal you want, and that might vary. There are different types of electrical information that are worth collecting for these interventions. You might want to stimulate. You might actually want to apply electrical energy to the nerve or the neurons to get something out of it. I'm going to come back to that at the very, very end. You need to, of course, process some of this stuff very close to the signal. You have to do a lot of data conditioning and front-end amplification to clean it up. You, of course, need to get power to these things. We're going to talk about that in a minute. That's really the big source. You need to talk to them. You need to talk to these arrays and these signals. And all the while, it's got to be small. It's got to be biocompatible, which is where we're going to go in a minute. It's got to be safe. And lastly, it's got to, hopefully last quite a while. And this is a problem. So now, after Kevin giving you this little intro, where am I going with all this? There's a big problem in today's electrophysiological neurotechnology. It's an understood problem for which there's a big literature. And that problem is that nothing that we put into the nervous system of this kind lasts. So none of these things, what you saw in those human patients, after a few years, they're mostly non-functional, technology stops working. There's certainly nothing that lasts, the way I say it, is an appreciable fraction, a substantial fraction of a primate's lifetime. That just doesn't exist today. And so then you might ask, well, why doesn't it exist today? Well, it doesn't exist for lots of reasons. It's actually a really complex problem. So, we can hit the big points. So, let's come at it from two different directions. Number one, you're a big bag of salt water, okay? So if I were to tell you, instead of writing it this way, I would flip it around and say, I want you to take a microchip that you designed for some other thing and throw it into the ocean and have it last for 25 years. Come back in 25 years and it'll be working. I think a couple of you are already smiling, right? It's sort of patently absurd when you say it that way. But when you don't say it that way and you talk about it, then it gets confusing. But the reality is it's the same problem, at least at zeroth order. That is to say that the way that we make electronics or any of these thin film technologies tend not to be robust to the types of failure modes you get when you throw things into salt water. You get water penetration through the insulation layers, you get material delamination, you get failure of the conductors, you get all of the usual kind of things that people are aware of in these other contexts. And they are aware of in this context, but that's a big deal. These things go bad. The other problem is going at it from thinking about it from the organism's perspective. So any area of your brain that is heavily, is dense with neurons is equally dense with capillaries, with blood vessels, because that's how the neurons, get their food. And this is why MRI works, because MRI is not measuring neural activity, it's measuring oxygenation locally in little areas, because that's a proxy for neural activity, right? And so what happens when you shove these things into brain is you go pop, 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 and you microembolize everything down as you're going down the stack. All those little vascular things get basically exploded, and then they get cleaned up most of the time. And so you can imagine that that's going to recruit a lot of local and systemic responses by the body. The body gets pretty pissed off when you do that. And one of the ones that has been recognized for a very long time is that you get encapsulation of the implant by glial cells. It's called gliosis. It's sort of this scar tissue idea. Now, someone showed, and by the way, let me add, and these are stiff, right? These are pretty stiff implants. And nothing to do with this sort of fibrous gelatinous nature of your cortex. And so someone showed quite a while ago that if, it was Daryl Kipke, in the mid-2000s, that if you can make your implant small enough, he was introducing, his group was introducing shanks, just like the ones I showed you. What they showed is if you shove in 150 micron wide shank, a millimeter long, versus a 50 micron one or a 60 micron or smaller, the very small ones didn't effectively, as far as they could tell, get very noticed by the cell response. They were small enough that the glial cells did not start building scar tissue all around it, whereas you had 120 or 150 micron thing and it was completely encapsulated by stuff, which is kind of that cartoon you see there. And so that, coupled with the observation that these very stiff things were connected by wires and sitting there essentially micro-sawing, as the things are going, you have this thing just sitting in this jello, made people begin to start addressing this problem from both directions. New materials, my group does both, so new materials and this issue of how do we get around the tissue response and how do we make better interfaces, okay? So along came the brilliant people at Berkeley, among, you know, in many other places. I don't want to overplay it, but I do want to point out, quite frankly, that a lot of the early work I'm about to talk about, really the state-of-the-art stuff, came out of Berkeley and Jan Rabai's group and Elad and Ricky Muller, who's now an assistant professor here. And so very early on, there was an observation that why don't we get rid of all these wires and make this wireless? And so there were attempts, if successful ones, I don't mean attempts like they didn't work, there was a work demonstrated where you could get these shanks and put little coils on them and then close everything up and talk to them from the outside. This is wonderful work from Brown, from Arto Numico's group, which does very mature technology now that's being phased, transitioned into lots of experiments where you can, you know, you have a craniotomy plug in the array and then all of this is wireless. This is a very mature sort of very elegant wireless stack. Ricky showed in collaboration with the electrodes made in my group that you could make an ASIC and have an antenna right on the electrodes, close everything up and have a little stamp size thing and everything could be wireless. So there were attempts made to miniaturize this and to make it wireless, kind of to start hitting at these things I was talking about. And they were generally successful, but you know, fairly large objects, right? And the number I want to give you to keep in mind as I finally get into the neural dust stuff in the last half hour is that, just very roughly speaking, the best you can do is about a microwatt of energy required per channel you're trying to record for the bandwidths you need for these systems. And you can only get so small if you're building a full front end. So if you're building a full electronic front end, like one of those chips up there, and you ask how much area does the little amplifier and all the things that you need to do a single channel, you're talking, you know, a few, maybe a millimeter squared, maybe you can get a little more aggressive and get on the hundreds of microns. Yeah?
What is the channel?
What is the channel? Thank you. The channel, by channel I mean every little electrode from which you would like to take a voltage reading, electrophysiological reading. This is all voltage recording. Yeah, that wasn't clear, so yeah. Thanks for saying that. And usually these things, by the way, I do this later in the talk, but you know, you're recording, as you know, voltage is differential. So you're recording from one, and then there's a counter electrode somewhere, some large ground. It's not really ground, but people call it ground. It's a large counter electrode. Okay. So now, what happened? So these things, you know, were being developed, and there was always this desire in the field to make them really small. Like, could you take an absurdly tiny implant? Could you make a 1 millimeter, fully, the whole thing is 1 millimeter, and you put it in, close everything up, and talk to it? Is that even reasonable? Could you make could you go crazy and do a 500 micron implant or whatever? And we looked at this here with Jan and Jose before the neural dust work, and many other groups, a number of other groups, I think three or four groups had been looking at it over the years and tried and failed. And what, you know, the approach was to do some sort of RFID type thing, some electromagnetic radio frequency type of thing. How small can we make it, and how we're so good now at low power radios and all this stuff, you know, can we do it? And the answer is no, you can't do it. And so if you want to see, the archive paper has all the math behind it, but let me walk you through why. So, and it's a qualified no. It's actually, I overstated on purpose. In a second you'll see it does work in some cases. But what's the story? The story is, let's say that you want to implant something, and we're going to call this little cartoon the implant. It's going to have something that receives energy and communicates back. Call it an antenna, call it a coil, whatever makes you happy. And then whatever little box is required to drive that. And then outside you're going to have some other thing that can be pretty large, and it'll have some size of also antenna or inductor coil to talk to these things. And you can model this. You can build a link channel model. You can put in as much detail as you want about spreading loss and attenuation and what frequency you're doing this at and whatever. And you can build a pretty accurate understanding of what happens at different scales. So let me show you what happens. So if you build these type of things, this type of thing. At a centimeter, on the x-axis is the size of the RX dimension, the size of the implant. You can think about it as the size of the coil if you want to make it the most permissive. At a centimeter, you're not doing so bad. And electromagnetics is going to work great at a centimeter. That ECOG that Ricky developed, that's about that size. There are many other very nice systems that will always work, well done, and it's a nice technology. You get to a millimeter, and it starts to look a little weird. And then you fall off a cliff. That's 100 microns. Now, why do you fall off a cliff? It's actually pretty easy to explain. There's two reasons. One is light is fast. So if something is fast in a medium, the wavelength that will have in a medium is very large. Okay, large wavelength. To capture energy, usually the thing you're using to capture energy has to be some substantial fraction of the wavelength. Otherwise, it's very hard to capture energy. Lambda over 2, lambda over 4, some number like that. Which means that for electromagnetic waves, you're kind of screwed, because 100 microns is not a good size. It's way too small for most things, at most reasonable, even like tens of gigahertz and all of the usual numbers that sound cool. The other problem is that you're a bag of salt water, and electromagnetic fields don't like going into bags of salt water. They get sucked up. There are windows, but they all suck. I mean, there's some windows, but none of them are great. And so what happens is you end up with a limit imposed by the FDA, which is comes out of this, which is, you really can only pack a few tens of milliwatts, really it's 10, but per centimeter squared before you can, when you start raising the temperature of the fluid, because all the energy is going into the water. So if you put this together, for a 1 millimeter squared interrogator outside, 100 micron implant, 2 millimeters away from each other, you get 4 picowatts of power, which even for, Alad and Jan and Ricky can probably do amazing things with 40 picowatts, but not exactly the greatest amount of power. And for those of you that are electrical engineers and you like seeing decibels, 100 micron moat, the resonant frequency for electromagnetics would be, somewhere around 9 or 10 or whatever the number is there. But the important part is you get 125 decibel single path loss. So go have fun with that number. All right. So what works? And I was asked to make this joke. I wasn't going to make it, but I'll make it. I make it every time. I'm kind of getting bored of the joke. But I always say, stop checking your email. This is like the only slide you have to look at for the whole talk. Then you can go back and check your email on your phone. Because I'm in the audience, and that's what I do when I'm in the audience. So anyway, so what works? What works really, really well is ultrasound. And the system is pretty straightforward. The idea is pretty straightforward to explain in this one cartoon. And the rest is just me trying to convince you that this works. So how does it work? So it turns out that electromagnetics aren't going to work, but ultrasound will work. And the reason ultrasound will work, and I'll put up, somebody's taking a picture of it, so I'll put up all the mumbo jumbo at one time. Why does it work? It works for the same reasons that it didn't work in electromagnetics. Sound is slow, so the wavelengths are dead on. 10 megahertz is about 175 microns that you need. It's perfect. And medical ultrasound goes all the way up to tens of megahertz, so it's perfect. And your body actually is reasonably transparent, with the exception of bone that I'll come back to. It's reasonably transparent to ultrasound. The loss is much, 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 much lower. Okay? And so what happens if you put these two things together is that ultrasound is actually a really nice medium to power up and communicate stuff that is really tiny. So what you do is you implant a little piezoelectric crystal, and you cut the crystal so that the thickness of the crystal is lambda over 2, wavelength over 2. So what will happen is you'll set up a resonance in the crystal, so the crystal will wiggle, if you send in ultrasound from the outside at the right frequency. So you send in ultrasound from the outside. This thing's outside, comes in, hits this thing, wiggles. Now what happens? A couple of things. Whatever you put here, even if it's not a special type of crystal, energy will bounce back. Just because it's hitting a dissimilar interface, I'm gonna do something unprofessional. Pull my shirt out. Energy is bouncing back, and you can see that. You can listen for that outside. Now, a couple of other things happen. One is, if this is a piezoelectric crystal and I have electrodes across it, when this thing begins to ring, it'll produce a voltage across it, and it'll be able to drive a current, which means that I can use that to power something next to the crystal implanted in. It's a mechanical to electrical transducer. And the other way around. So that means that I could use this essentially to power something connected to it. Now, here's the trick. The trick is, if I can build some circuit here, just shown as a variable resistor, which it isn't, but just something, if I can build some circuit that, as a function of a neuron firing or some other interesting signal, can modulate the impedance across this crystal, the amount of energy reflected from this crystal will change as a function of that. It's like a tuning fork that I tap when I want to, and someone can tell that that's happening. So all I have to do is sit out here, hit it, and listen. And as long as I know what's going on, and if I can in fact do this, I can reconstruct what's happening inside the body very nicely, very elegantly. You can also see that I drew this in an analog way. You can make this digital. This is very, very similar to the way your subway cards work, a near field and RFID. This is just done with ultrasound. You can sit there and encode ones and zeros if you want. You could build all sorts of stuff around this platform. So that's the whole idea. That's it. So now what I want to do is I want to show you kind of what the data looks like. We have, I think if I go 15 more minutes, we'll have a little bit of time for questions, which I think would be the funner. I'm not supposed to say funner. My wife corrects me. The more fun?
Enjoyable.
Enjoyable. Thank you. Having kids now, every time I make grammar mistakes, my wife's like, funner doesn't, not a word, funner does not exist. Okay, so let me show you, just to kind of skip to the story here, and I think this talk might not have all the detail I wanted, so I might even in real time switch to another talk. But let me show you what these things look like, and then I'll talk a little bit about where we're going with this. So this, all of this was published in Neuron in August. And so I want to walk you through how it works, and if I'm missing a slide, like I said, I'll pull it up because I kind of want to show you the innards of it a little bit. So this is a millimeter on a side. It's certainly not 100 microns. It's a piezoelectric cube. You see it here from the side and here from the top. And there's a little circuit on this little silicon chip that's connected to that piezo. And the circuit is absurdly simple. And this is why I realized it's not on here. Maybe it's on the next slide. I'm going to leave you hanging when I come back and tell you what the circuit is. And actually, I'm actually very proud that that worked, because it's absurd. We didn't think it was going to work, and it worked. Now we're, of course, building more sophisticated stuff. But anyway, so there's something there connected to the piezo, like I promised. And then on the back are these little recording electrodes that we're going to use to take data. And when we make them, we actually make them with tails, so that we can take data. Here you see it right before surgery. You can actually take data, what we call ground truth or gold standard data. We can take data right through the wires first so that we can have a one-to-one comparison from what we're reconstructing to what reality is. When we're running these experiments, of course, in real life, so to speak, you wouldn't need details. This is built purposefully out of technology anybody can use. We have other versions I'll talk about at the end that are super fancy sort of Ferraris that can only be done here at Berkeley and the nanofab and all that. But the beauty of this is that anybody, after reading this paper, could go to the right manufacturer and have someone put all this together. The outside is interrogated using a chip that was developed by Bernhard Boser's group here, which is rather an elegant chip. And what it does is it allows you to drive multiple different transducers, ultrasonic transducers, and both in receive and transmit mode. And so you can do this kind of like send and receive I was talking about. That was developed for a different application. It turned out, really, just because it's Berkeley, that we went to talk to them, and everybody was excited to work together to do this. And then there's an FPGA board that talks to this, that does all of the calculations that have to be done to do this. So let me show you what the circuit looks like. You ready? Because I know I recognize a couple of you like hardware. Okay, here's the piezo. It's a single FET. And here's how the single FET works. So you have a single FET. It's a pretty big FET. It's a humongous FET by normal standards. But it is fabricated in TSMC process. It's laid out, and we get it back. And then what we do is you take the gate and you expose it to the extracellular fluid. That's one of those pads I showed you, those electrodes. And now the other one can't be connected directly to the source, because then you'd have current running through it and you'd have a problem. So what you do is you take two matched resistors and you make what's effectively an AC ground and use that as the counter. And this is the other electrode that's exposed to the solution. So now what happens is very simple. Whenever you get a little firing event out here, you modulate the current from drain to source through the FET. And in fact, it's enough modulation that you get a detectable change on the piezo and then a detectable change out at the receiver. Now, I think those of you that like circuits can imagine how much you can replace this with much more advanced, intelligent stuff. And I'll talk about it at the end of what's happened since then. But what you're going to see is data of that moat, or a moat like it, sutured on to the muscle of a rat and the sciatic nerve of a rat. The muscle to show electromyograms, and the sciatic nerve to show compound action potential of a peripheral nerve, which is a big deal, like I mentioned, these days. And so that is the actual sciatic nerve of a rat. And what we'll do is we will use, in these experiments, Olympus cylindrical transducer, which will be placed up against the rat. Packets, or pulses rather, sorry, will be sent, and then the reflected signal will be collected and processed. So because I have a little bit of time, I'm going to beg your indulgence. I didn't realize that this, let me see if it's at the end of the talk. Did I even have it here? No. So give me a second. I'm going to open up, and I do this in real time. I do want to show you, I thought I had them. I want to show you what it actually looks like in some detail, because I think it's kind of fun. This is the slightly more technical talk. Okay. So I'm not going to go through all this, but I do want to show you how it works. So the way this system works, so let's say that the top row one, they're all Roman numerals. Row one is the actual change in voltage, extracellular voltage, is a function of a neuron firing. And you get, like, let's say you get that hump. And you can see it's milliseconds on the x-axis and millivolts on the y-axis. All right, so what happens? So that's what's happening in, let's say that's what's happening in the nerve. Well, the first thing is every 100 microseconds, we send out 6 pulses, an ultrasound, pop, 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 pop. And the frequency of this is chosen so that it's at that lambda over 2 that I talked about for the crystal. So that happens, we send that in, and immediately we switch to receive and we listen. And so if you look at the receiver signal, this is junk. That's feed through from the transmit signal. This is just junk. And as soon as you start listening, you capture this stuff right here. Now, that doesn't look like much, but as soon as you get rid of this low frequency stuff, you get a beautiful little set of packets coming back. Okay? Now, what do those packets look like? They look like that. This is the return. This is the things that bounce back off the crystal. You get different combinations of pulses. So we sent out 6, and it turns out that 6 come back several times. And why does that happen? Because there isn't just a crystal. There's the front of the crystal, the back of the crystal, the back of the little board. All those things cause reflections of different amplitudes, and you collect them. But what's cool, the reason I wanted to show you this, is that some of these, like this area here, some of these come out of the crystal and are responsive to the neural signal. But some of them don't, like say these two areas here. They're going to not change at all with the neural signal. But all of them will change if the orientation moves a little bit. And so I have a built-in way of backing out motion artifact because everything's going to change when the thing twitches a little bit. But only this stuff is going to change when the nerve fires. And we know exactly how it changes. And so what we do is we filter it, we rectify it, we take areas under the curve, essentially we integrate, and we reconstruct one signal. And this is, I'm going to show you the data in a better way, but that, you know, leads to a reconstruction that is very close. Now, the problem, there are problems. The problem with this approach is that with a single FET, you're kind of limited to your noise floor, you know, effectively your noise floor. Like, what is the tiniest, smallest signal you can record with a FET with no actual real front end? It's about 180, 150 microvolts. And that's good for these types of peripheral things, not the greatest if you're trying to pick up tiny 10 or 20 microvolt spikes in the brain, for example. And I'll talk about that. And then the other issue is that as the thing wiggles, if it wiggles misalignment, or I guess I didn't put it on here. This is the misalignment plot. There's a similar plot for rotational excursions. The amount of power that gets to them changes too. And so if the amount of power drops, the total signal difference drops, and the effective noise floor goes up. It gets worse. And so those are all problems with the basic technology that would have to be addressed. So let me switch now. We're almost, you know, really getting kind of near the end of this because I want to just show you the data and then open it for questions. So switching back to the original talk, another point I want to make is that what's remarkable is that all of this works at a tiny fraction of the FDA limit for ultrasound power. So the FDA limits for peak and average power are up there, right there, 720, 190. And you can compare them to what we're doing. And it's much, much smaller. So it's actually, not only is it really safe, there's a lot of headroom to power to deliver more power to things in a safe way. And that's another thing, you know, that's being explored now. I can come back to this if people like ultrasound. Here's the electromyogram preparation. So let me just show you the data. The left top plot is the actual recording with wires, so it's what we call the ground truth. It's sampled at 100 kilohertz. And the right is the reconstructed data using the method I just described, and the effective sampling rate for that is 10 kilohertz. That's as fast as you can do all this stuff. And you can see that the reconstruction is pretty good for muscle. In every case, systemically, and actually we still don't know what this is, it doesn't happen for the neural signal, which I'll show you in the next slide, which is like dead on. But in every case of the muscle, there was this weird little lag, but otherwise it's beautiful data. You get the what's called a sigmoidal recruitment curve as you stimulate the muscle harder and harder and harder, and you get a bigger and bigger signal out of the muscle. It's a very classic curve. And then for the compound action potential data, this is the same story. You have the the gold standard, and then the reconstructed, and then the sort of recruitment curve for the sciatic nerve. And so what's going on here, just to kind of take a pause, and why do we think this is a big deal, and why was this work, I think, so well received? What you're doing is you're putting a 1 millimeter scale object, closing everything up, and then from the outside watching a nerve or a muscle fire with no, there's no radios, no wires, there's nothing. And more important than that, because I think if the, that was the whole story, someone would say, well, you know, I could probably do it about the scale with some EM thing. The story, the big deal is two things. One, I can do this, and that's what we're going to go to next. I can do this centimeters into the body, and physics showed, and in our Journal of Neuroscience Method paper shows, that I could keep scaling this down to extremely small sizes, something you can't really do otherwise. So the dream, what I want to spend the last slide or two on, the dream here is, you know, 100 micron object, a 50 micron object that's doing spike recording. You can imagine how transformative that would be, and systems for recording from very deep. So I'll hit both of those in a minute because I want to leave you with a big story. So what are we, first of all, before my big final, like, where do I think this is going, at a very in the weeds level, what are we doing next? So we, you know, not wanting to simply do this single transistor, we taped out and received back a chip. It's a 400 micron by, I think, 800 micron chip that should be able to do, fits into the same package I just showed you, but is digital backscatter, and should be able to do 10 microvolts of effective noise floor. So we expect that this thing will be able to do single unit recording in a peripheral nerve for a just slightly smaller size than the thing I showed you, but about the same size. So we're pretty excited by that. And it's all digital backscatter, so it'll just send back ones and zeros instead of this analog thing. We are hard at work making smaller and smaller motes. So that's today the millimeter scale mote that you saw in the neuron paper today looks like that. It's actually exactly a millimeter cubed. There are smaller ones being produced now with the microfab. So this is one that is made in the nanofab totally with solid state, you know, thin film kind of processes. This is a 150 micron dummy that we started putting into sciatic nerves. And we're looking at ways of fabricating these and assembling them, and we're moving pretty fast. There's some pretty neat stuff that was just submitted for review on that. We've moved to more advanced systems for the wearable part. So this is, we needed this for rats, although you can see it's probably applicable to humans. So this is a little rat wearable system. This is the actual system. It works. It was just submitted for publication. And the transducer now, instead of being an Olympus head, is a tiny little multi-element send and receive beam steering, ultrasound beam steering system that's run with a very, very fast a 40 megahertz ADC microcontroller, really nice custom. This whole is custom built system. The whole thing, you know, can beam steer, can track, can run clustering algorithms and things like that to do a much better job of backing out the data. With Ricky Muller, we worked about a year and a half ago now, I think the project started. We began working on a stimulation mode. I promised I'd talk about that. So they just got their chip back, and I think it's looking good. And so we are moving now to put that all together, package it, and move to first experiments, where what we do is use the power instead of for recording. We collect the power and we stimulate nerves. And that's going to be, I think, another game changer, because we'll be able to use this for interventions. And lastly, there's a whole different talk I could give you, again, also just submitted for review, where we've changed the entire material stack how these things are made to use a very exciting inert material. I'll leave it there to do all this stuff, and we're pretty excited by the way where that will go. And then lastly, CNS, you know, exclamation point, exclamation point, exclamation point. We are now very aggressively going after the 50 micron mote dream to do this in the cortex. And you should all ask me whatever questions you want about that. I want to leave enough time for questions. But let me tell you another story. Okay. I think this is that's all going to be big impact, but I think there's a bigger story here. And this is the thing that's driving a lot of us. I don't have to do neural recording with this. I can record whatever I want. If I can build a little oxygen sensor, pH sensor, pressure sensor, temperature sensor, whatever sensor, as long as I can find a way to miniaturize it and get it on a backscatter system, I can now Fitbit your organs. And we're pushing this pretty hard. I'm serious. Imagine having on your liver a little mote that is a speck of sand, and every morning when you go to the bathroom, somebody takes a little data off your liver and says, okay, you know, or having deep body temperature for your gastrointestinal tract. All things that sound a little funny, but they're not. They're actually, there's big unexplored territory here. Very little work has ever been done on this kind of stuff, because how could you ever do it? Well, what this offers, this platform offers, is a way of getting data in and out to very deep structures in the human body that just generally were just inaccessible without things that, you know, in a research lab, I'll have a bunch of wires coming out of a sheep model or something, but no one's going to agree to that unless they're very ill, and certainly no one's going to have that as part of their daily routine. And so this is blue sky, and it's a way off, but we're hitting it very hard. For example, Mikhail Anwar, who's a brilliant sort of both EE chip designer and radiation oncology, UC Berkeley, MD, PhD, and I have been working with Chris Pister, the three of us, on a project which is making good progress on using this to detect the resurgence of tumor cells after a tumor resection. So the problem is you remove a tumor, and you'd like to know very, very fast if anything comes back. And by the time you can image something with an imager, you have a cluster that's large enough that, you know, it would have been nice to know a lot sooner. And we think we can essentially leave a few of these things in after the tumor resection and then just do the standard radioisotope labeling that people do and very quickly say, I got a few pings, something's here, and much, much sooner than you could with imaging. So that's one example, but there's a bunch that are now sort of exploding, sort of the thousand flowers blooming. So I think this is a big deal. I want to leave you with that. I want to thank you. This is the group. These are all the people that let me give talks. And I always end with this, my humorous observation. This is a very, very recent picture. It's about 3 months old. That's my daughter, who's clearly very excited about science. And who can find my son? Anybody see my son? He's like, whatever. These people are all annoying. I don't know what they're doing. Anyway, so that's not true. They both love science. All right, with that, thanks. And I'll take any questions. So I think I have five or six minutes. Thank you.
Ready for questions?
Since it's me.
I'm curious about how things are looking for trying to miniaturize these to put them into the CNS. Like, I'm not a domain expert, but I imagine you'd also have a more complex signal. And maybe you're going to face even more difficulties with durability?
Yep. So the CNS problem was really hard. And so although it started that way, the dream started with CNS, I think we're always very careful to conservative, in terms of what we assert. But we are absolutely doing this. And I'm very bullish. I'm just trying to be sort of responsible upon a stage. So here are the challenges. It needs to be, somewhere in the around 50 microns, maybe plus or minus something, to really be a game changer as opposed to a novelty item. And I'm very big about not generating academic novelty items. So I think we're really going to have to go after that hard. And what does that mean? It means that you have to be very careful about what you can really fit on there, develop all of the fabrication for that. But more importantly, if you're also doing this, the hit the ball out of the park result would be that 50 micron object can record single units. Single units in the CNS, accounting for all sorts of variations and whatever, you probably have to have a 10, 20 microvolt noise floor, right? Because if you're lucky, you'll get 50 microvolts, maybe a little more. Some people, you can get much more. Sure, that's true, but not on an average. On average, you want to make sure you can catch the little signals too. So you're talking about doing, let's call it, 20 microvolt noise floor in a 50 micron package. That requires some pretty clever engineering on the side of the recording thing. We're working with Ricky Muller now to kind of look at that problem. You have packaging problems, you have delivery, and then you have another big problem, which I just hired a postdoc in communications and imaging, and we're just starting to talk to Mickey Lustig about this, and Laura Waller and Elad. You have the skull, and the skull is a massive scatterer. And so the question is, okay, I can give you what's the flip answer? I'm going to leave a little tiny 2 millimeter craniotomy port and pop a little loss engine there, and then the skull doesn't matter. What I'd like the answer to be is, if I have multiple transducers over a fairly large area, each doing fairly low power, but together they can get through in the same way that people get through scattering media today. Can I tell you that's going to work? No idea. We're just starting. That's kind of like, this is why I love my job. It's all this sort of crazy, what can we do next kind of stuff. So those are the challenges of the CNS, I think. almost.
So backing up a little bit on the overall sort of physical information system, you've got a volume where information is being generated, and kind of a little bit of a dilemma. You have a surface over which you can get the information out.
Right. Yeah.
So even just power-wise,
okay.
Is there a dilemma there?
Yes. Okay. George Church and Jose and I and a bunch of other, Conrad Cording, a bunch of other people got together about 4 years ago over in Boston, and we wrote a paper looking at this problem, which is, you know, could you, using any technology that you think is reasonable plus some epsilon, is there a way to get all the information out of a rat brain, even defining it as whatever information we have today, right? You could always argue there's more. This is a very, very... absolutely, you're right. Okay, now what's my... Let me do a short, quick and then longer answer. The quick answer, I have a way to get out of that problem, which is none of this is intended to suck out most of the information or even a tiny fraction of the information of the brain. It's intended to run a brain-machine interface clinical system, and for that, I only need about 100 channels. So if I can get 100 channels, workable channels out of this, you can run pretty much any BMI prosthetic today, and it's already in a large enough parameter space to do amazing stuff. And so, focusing on what we care about, which is that, a clinically applicable thing, I can avoid answering your question, right? The longer thing, if I want to engage with the question, it's very complex. I think you absolutely have this classic problem of volume to surface. You have heat generation issues that are very substantial. And so I think no one has quite, I think that paper that I mentioned was the closest that anybody's done, but no one has quite put their finger on really what is the ultimate limit if you look at how much information is there and so on. Because the reason no one has is that it's all an engineering trade-off. There is no golden answer. So what do I mean? If you're a neuroscientist, let's say you would like to see every neuron spike sampled at 25 kilohertz, but probably you don't need that for certain types of uses of the information. Maybe 2-3 kilohertz will work. There's like another dozen of these trade-offs where you kind of have to ask, what do you really want in the data? And then maybe I can tell you whether the problem you just outlined can be fixed, can be addressed for that problem. Does that make sense? Yeah. And by the way, and let me just say, I don't mean this facetiously, but I do want to get to the core of it because it comes up a lot. And this is now just my opinion, full stop. If the question is motivated, and I'm not saying yours is, but if the question is motivated by, will someday I be able to download my brain in real time, there are actually much deeper, well, I know that isn't, but just to point it out, there are actually very powerful arguments against the notion that a single recording would ever do that, even if we got to your question. I know that's not where it was coming from, but it's a good time to put that in there. You can come talk to me if you want. Why? I think this gentleman had a question.
Are there different ways of inserting these devices?
Mine or the arrays I showed or all or?
Yeah, any.
Any? Yeah. So the spiky arrays have some fairly developed technologies. Yeah, and mine, and so ours, the default for the CNS, we intend to deliver them pushed into the ends of these arrays and then retract the array. There are bluer sky approaches that people have explored. There's a really nice paper out of Australia last year, snaking up through an artery and up the vasculature and parking a recording electrode inside the vasculature and then doing a brain recording. There are limitations to that, the lining produces. If you're not in the skull, if you're in the peripheral nervous system, it's laparoscopic, endoscopic, and those are pretty developed, actually. So you can get them in. These are so small, you get them in at the end of a cannula, and then you can kind of suture them on.
Any thinking about
non-surgical ones? Yeah, so there are a couple, but they're all what I would say are in the blue sky area. So for example, one which is not surgical but is invasive is that you might be able to get, if you get your particles very small, you might be able to load them through the cerebral spinal fluid, which pumps itself around your brain constantly. There are limitations to what that could do, and I think that's extremely exploratory. So we're thinking about these things, but I want to be careful because it's all still in the realm of out there.
Last question.
I don't know if you want to wait for the mic or be really loud.
So I was curious, you're mentioning in current, clinical prostheses and stuff, the 100 channel is sort of the gold standard, I guess. What do you see as the limits of that for, more, as you're saying, blue sky, like future approaches?
What is the limit in the number of channels, or what's the technology going to be able to do with an implantable shank?
I guess, if this technology that you're developing does become as good as it theoretically could be.
How many channels maybe could I get? Is that the question?
Both how many channels could you get and what is a reasonable threshold of, what can you do with the amount of channels you can get?
Yeah, what can you do with the amount of channels? Well, so what can you do with the amount of channels is a question for Jose, because to be honest, it's a brain-machine interface question that's a bit subtle. The naive answer that I would give you is, if you look at the parameter space of, say, an arm being moved, or even a speech prosthetic, 100 degrees of freedom is way more than you need. That is a bit of a glib answer, because I think you can always go and find that that's an approximation and you could do better and so on. Technologically, there are now ongoing, right now, fairly mature attempts to, not using untethered stuff, but using tethered spikes and other things to get thousands and thousands of channels. Most of those attempts are intended for science, not for clinical use. They just want to do like full volume sampling of an area of cortex and so on. They're not really intended. No one's ever arguing, I need 2,000 channels to run a BMI. So somewhere in between those two answers is reality. And the answer is I'd want to be careful that I come up with a number and, say 256 or something. But I think you're in the right ballpark if you can do 100. Now, if we start dreaming science fiction and I want to run 43 different peripherals, or I want to talk to my phone, and then you start to, then we're talking about science fiction novels, so who knows, right? But I think 100 degrees of freedom is a pretty crazy amount of parameter space. All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.